Namaskar friends. Today we will be discussing the trident of desire, peace and bliss, and try to figure out how we can overcome the karma bandhans or the rina bandhan in order to attain salvation, liberation, moksha or nirvana. So I would be using a lot of slokas, mostly from the Bhagavad Gita today, to help us decode this valuable information, which helps us understand what changes we can make on a daily basis that will help us overcome the elusive trap of Maya. So, as you can see, there are three stages in which Maya operates. There are two prime forces in the Brahman, which includes the Shiva Chitta or the consciousness, which is directed inwardly or introvert, and the Prana Shakti, Kali Shakti, Maya, which is directed outwards. Tendency of the Prana Shakti is to emanate outwards and expand away from the Chitta with an attempt to pull the central kernel of Chitta with it while it expands. That happens during periods of Srishti or creation of the universe. Now, as you can imagine, you cannot expand a ball all the time without distorting the nucleus. So, the nucleus wants to remain in the center, introverted, and there is a magnetic force trying to pull it apart. So that will happen to destroy or disintegrate the kernel core of Chitta. That's why Chitta wants to remain inward directed. And by that we mean it wants to be introverted and not get allured by the pull of these outward forces, which we call desires. So that's why you have to understand the pull and the push and the pull here. The pull is that of the Maya trying to expand, and the push is more coming from the Chitta, which is saying, okay, Maya, you can expand, but I'm not going to be pulled towards you. So it is not trying to pull the prana towards itself, but it wants to remain in the status quo. So desires are the magnetic pulling force that help continue the trap of Maya by creating more and more things that you have to do and distract you away from this introspection or dhyana, if you will, that the Chitta specializes in. So that primordial initial desire was the reason for the first incarnation in the first Srishti that would have formed. After that, even if you want to go back, you cannot go back. So that one-way trap door is the trap of delusionary Maya. And that operates on the left axis here in the realm of desire. When you break this or want to break this realm of desire, you have to use the central pillar. The central pillar of peace, which as you can see, will make you what we call sthit pragya. So the kam nirlipt, or the person totally engrossed in kama or desire, becomes sthit pragya before he can advance to the ultimate state where he was lying, where he was initially, which is the shivchit. So that will be gunatit, which is transcending the three gunas. Kama, prakriti has created these three gunas or material modes of nature called sattva, rajas and tamas. So now, having known that, this is leading to entrapment, embodiment, central pillar is neutral, and bliss or the third pillar is leading to liberation, moksha, enjoyment within Shiv Chitta tendency. But this bliss here represents a balance, sat chit anand. That's what the bliss is. Not just anand, but it is sat chit anand. Because when you are only thinking about Anand, you tend to get diverted in the realm of desire. And instead of Anand, you are getting a lot of Jarmrityu Jaravyadhi doshas. So, Sat Chit Anand, where there is a balance between awareness and enjoyment. Sat means good balance. Chit means consciousness or awareness. And Anand means enjoyment. So, when there is a good balance between introspection, internal awareness of who am I, so that you don't damage other similar Atmans around you, who are also trying to attain the same thing by enjoying but not at others' expense. So that is why the Chit component, the Shiva Chit, is the awareness or the Brahmanical neutrality that has to be respected all the time. Now, so let's talk about some terms from Bhagavad Gita to understand what is desire and how to overcome it, become sthit pragya and then become gunatit. The first thing that we need to know is that Krishna will repeatedly emphasize on the importance of jnan. As you can well imagine, jnan or wisdom or knowledge is what helps us break the desire pillar of prana. That's why jnanmay sharir is the fourth kosha or the sheath lying internal to the annamay, pranamay, manomay, jnanmay and anandmay. So anandmay or bliss is preceded by jnan. So jnan I want to equate with wisdom more than knowledge. You can say knowledge, but I prefer the term wisdom. You can still have knowledge and do the wrong thing. When knowledge is combined with appropriate application of the knowledge, that is wisdom to me. That is a jnani. Lot of individuals will know just by reading the scripture, swadhyay, what is knowledge, but they will not apply. That application of the right knowledge is wisdom. And that will bring state of sthit pragya or stoicism in the modality of peace. So jnana is important, and Krishna has said that there are three kinds of jnana based on the gunas in that desire. Because once you have fallen from the chitta realm into the prana realm in this world, like we are a biological life that is a combination of Shiv Chitta in a body that is prana. So that when we have fallen, now we have to follow the rules of the Prakriti. This is the rule of the Purush. This is the rule of the Prakriti. This is the rule of the witnesser. This is the rule of the doers. Prakriti kriyamarani gunai karmani sarvasha ahankar bhumatma kartaham iti manyate. The chitta is deluded to think it is the doer when it comes as a biological life. And that is what creates more karmbandhans and further punarjanams. So, when I was saying you have to follow the realm of desire or kama or prakriti, you have to follow the gunas. Three gunas exist in prakriti, material modes of nature. Sattva of lightedness or balance, rajas of excitation or passion, and tamas of indolence, sloth, status quo, inertia. So, we have to always be abiding by these three. And try to be moving towards sattva, only use rajas or excited passion when we have to break certain indolence, break certain inertia or addiction, bad pattern, evil pattern that is leading to more karmbandhan and punarjanams. So gunas, the three gunas are sattva, rajas and tamas. So jnana is also sattvic, rajasic and tamasic. What does Krishna say about jnana? He says, Sarbhuteshu yenekam bhavam avyamikchate avibhaktam vibhakteshu taj jnanam vidhi sattvikam prithaktven tu yaj bhavan nana bhavan prithak vidhan vetti sarveshu bhuteshu taj jnanam vidhi rasam yatu kritas vedak asmin kare saktam hetukam atatvar vidalam cha tat tamsam udharitam. So those are the three Sanskrit definitions of sattvic, rasic, tamasic. Let's come to sattvic jnana, which is what we should aim for. Sarbhuteshu yenekam bhavam avyam ikchate. everybody, if you have the bhav or the feeling or understanding that they are, despite their individual discriminations and identities, they are part of unit imperishable, one imperishable. Sarbhuteshu yenekam bhavam avyuchate avibhaktam vibhakteshu. Despite their divisions, they are undivided one. Avibhaktam vibhakteshu sarbhuteshu yenekam bhavam avyuchate avibhaktam vibhakteshu taj gyanam vidhi sattvikam. That knowledge is sattvic. Prithaktventu yaj bhava nana bhavan prithak vidhan. When you are trying to discriminate and identify each of these individuals, so-called individual, ego identity, as discriminate and different from the rest. Prithaktvain, prithak hai, different hai. Prithaktvain tu yaj gyanam nana bhavan prithak vidhan, veti sarveshu bhuteshu, taj gyanam vidhi rasam. When you think of individual souls as distinct and unconnected, entirely different from one another, then you are having rajasic gyan. यत्यु कृतस वेदक अस्मिन कार्य सक्तम हेतुकम अतत्वात् वदत्वम च तत्ताम समुदायतम. नाउ फर्दर, फर्स्ट वॉज डिवाइडेड बट यूनाइटेड एंड सिंगल सॉलिटरी इम्परिशेबल एंड इनडिफरेंट फ्रॉम ईच अदर, दैट इज सात्विक. रजासिक इज यू आर एंटायरली डिवाइडेड, डिस्टिंक्ट एंड यू आर अनरिलेटेड टू ईच अदर. रजासिक. तमासिक टेक्स इट वन स्टेप फर्दर. इट इज नॉट ओनली यू आर डिवाइडेड एंड डिफरेंट, डिस्टिंक्ट फ्रॉम ईच अदर. It has gone into the subdivisions of each fragment. You are entirely fragmental and it is concentrating on one individual without thinking of the whole. So when that knowledge is extremely fragmented, concentrating on the individual particles, subparticles, without having any respect and identity of the entire universe, without being based in reason or truth, atatvarth, without tattva or the facts, that knowledge is tamasic. So you see, the knowledge in Sattvic understands that although this has been reflected in different places, it is the image of the same single Brahman. And Rajasic says, no, this image is different from this image and there are certain differences and they are not related to each other. And Tamas is just focusing on that one single replica of the thousands of images, losing the forest for this single tree and then finding that, there is nothing we can do about it, not established in reason or facts or truth. So, whenever we are thinking about any action we do, we have to use this concept. If we see a homeless person on the road, we have to see the soul is the same. I could have been trapped in that body. So, if I am able to help that individual, I am going to help that individual. That is the compassion of the anhata. Once you have transcended the first three chakras, the subsistence of muladhara, which is what the homeless person is dealing with, swadhisthana recreation, which is what we personal, professional, career-wise, we have gained so much, we are enjoying, creating, procreating. And the third one is the solar plexus, manipura, which is ambition, creativity. I will do more things in this world, getting more power, possession, respect. That is manipura. When you transcended those three, then you have gone to the love of anatta, compassion. You feel the same way that individual feels. So how can you not help them? That why it's the anhata, compassion, represents the sarbhuteshu yenekam bhavam avyam ikchate, sattvik gyan. Okay, so now you know the three kinds of gyan. Why is gyan important again? Gyan is important because it will shatter the delusion of prakriti, prana, maya shakti. Like it is said, तस्मात् ज्ञान संभूतम हिस्थम ज्ञान सिनात्मना चित्वनम संशयम योगो अतिष्ठतेश भारत. तस्मात् ज्ञान संभूतम. Using the jnana, dispel the doubts that are lying in your desire-laden heart. Tasmat jnana sambhutam, histham jnana chinatmana, chitvainam sanshayam. Chitvainam is to destroy sanshay or doubt. Chitvainam sanshayam, skepticism, doubt. Chitvainam sanshayam, yoga matishtutis bharata. When you are situated in yoga, you will rise with the power of yoga by dispelling the doubts created by the burden of desire in the heart. Very loaded shloka, the last shloka of chapter 4. So, tasmat jnana sambhutam hristam jnana sinatmana chitvainam sanshayam yogotishtish bharata. You have to, this shloka tells you three things actually. It tells you that the desires that we have always talked about are lying in the heart, but the characteristic of desires are three. The first characteristic is desires are demanding in nature. This thing has to be done. That very moment when you demand something unequivocally, authoritatively, emphatically, you have closed down any discussion about the pros and cons. awareness has died there. Shiv Chitta has been muted. So that is demand. Desire creates demand. Demand destroys love. The moment you have an angle to something, you cannot help that homeless person lying on the street because you have an angle. Creation, procreation, ambition, you are in your own purposeful direction. You cannot think about this person. Compassion cannot arise. Passion has overtaken compassion. So the passion to do something bigger in life, the Manipura, has burned the drum of Anhata. That is why desires create demand and demand destroys love. So the love which will create the compassion in Anhata cannot happen. That is the first lesson we learn from this shloka. Second is, desires create confusion. Because you want something that is beyond yourself, you're trying to engage with something external whose nature you're not aware of. So there is some doubt, confusion, skepticism about whether I can attain it, what will happen when I attain it, how much enjoyment will I get, will there be any repercussions or consequences to it. All that creates skepticism, doubt, and doubt leads to ignorance, and ignorance is tamas. So desires create doubts, which creates ignorance, which creates tamasic indolence, inertia, and agyan. So gyan, which is knowledge, awareness, consciousness, has been counteracted by the desires, which have created doubt, skepticism, tamasic, ignorance, agyan. And the third thing is, it's a self-perpetuating cycle. That's the game of prana. You keep expanding, so you get more characters, more individual chittas in it, so that they will be converted from chitta into prana, and they will keep expanding this delusionary web of maya, more and more, it keeps expanding beyond. So that is why desires create desires. So three lessons: desires create demands, demands destroy love, love which would have created compassion has been overridden by the demand pursuits or the passion. Second is, desires create doubts and skepticism, which in turn creates tamasic ignorance or agyan. And desires will perpetuate further desires, so that this vicious cycle of doubt, ignorance, tamasic agyan, and the vicious cycle of demands, passion, destruction of compassion at anatta can continue, and we will sink further because we will be perceiving our passions as sakam karma. We will be loading up more karmas in the karmic body, the causal body. Three bodies, right? The sthul sharir, the outward body that everybody can see, that we believe this is life, enjoy life and die. And then there is this sukshm sharir, the mental body, if you will, composed of manas, buddhi, ahamkar. And then there is the karan sharir, which is carrying the kernel, the sediment of karma bandhans from all the lives that you have had, in addition to the Atman. That is the, once you break the karma bandhan, then the Atman is liberated to be going and merging into the Sahasrara, into the realm of the Satchitanin. So friends, now we understand that Gyan is important, because Gyan is anti-desire. Agyan is desire, and Gyan is peace, which is free of desire. So that free of desire, there's a shloka that says, Vihai kamane sarvan pumans charti nispriha nirmamo nirahankar sam dukshuk sami. So when you're devoid of vihai kamanya, in chapter 2 he says, when you're devoid of kama, vihai kamane sarvan pumans charti nispriha, once you have been devoid of all the kama means three things. Kama or desire will have three components. The three components are, of course, that of I want something, ego, viven components, but those are nispriha, nirmamo, nirahankar. That's why he says, Vihai kamane sarvan pumans charti nispriya nirmam nirahankar sam dukshuk sami. Once we have eradicated, once we have jettisoned these three qualities out of our ego, ego does not exist. So nirspriha is free of cravings. Nirmamo is free of proprietorship or ownership. And nirahankar is free of identification. When you want an apple, first thing is, You see that apple and identify it as an apple. The second is, you have ownership that, okay, I got $2, I can buy that apple. And then, of course, you enjoy that apple. And that apple of sin, in this case, Eve, will drive you further into karma bandhan, and the Adam or the chitta never gets out of it. Just a simile I just thought of while we were talking about. So basically, you have to get rid of desires or cravings, I should say. Kama or desire is composed of three ladders, three rungs. The three rungs that you have to step over to get over desires are those of nispriha, nirmamo, nirahankar. That is nispriha, free of cravings, nirmamo, free of proprietorship or ownership, and nirahankar is free of ego identification. Once you have gone beyond those three, then you are in the mold of sthitpragya. Sthitpragya is stoicism. Sthitpragya is what has been lauded by the ancient Roman philosophers, Greek philosophers as the highest quality. What Marcus Aurelius talks about, Epictetus, Seneca talk about, what a lot Plato, Aristotle and Socrates have talked about. So you see, both the Roman and the Greek philosophers, they were big proponents of the philosophical idea of stoicism when they were contemplating about presence of God. So sthitpragya, stoicism, is the ability to tolerate all the hurdles that are being sent your way. And obviously they are sent for a good reason. The karma bandhan, the prarabdha karma that is unfolding as we enjoy this world or suffer in this world, that is unfolding. So you have to be just a witnesser. Become, the moment you have become stoic, nispriha, nirmama, nirahankar, not having any wishes, but with gratitude and courage, facing all the problems that are coming to you, you are slowly burning off the karma bandhan. The karma bandhan is getting slashed off. Your current shari is becoming lighter and lighter. You are not creating new sakam karma that is going to be fructifying, because desire wants you to do something through the forces of prana. Once you have done something, there is a reactionary force. Prana, when it goes, spikes up, has to go down. That's only way the neutrality, Brahmanical neutrality, supersedes both chitta and prana, because both chitta and prana are lying in the Brahman. So Brahman is Brahmanical neutrality. That's why sattva is the highest guna of the gunas. And that's why we have to be sattvic in this pranic mode. Okay, so now we talk about the second path, about peace. So how do we attain peace? How do we become sthitpragya? The sthitpragya involves doing certain things which Patanjali will say, Ashtang Yoga, the eight limbs of the yoga, which we have talked about, Yam, Niyam, Asan, Pranayam, Pratyahar, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi. Those are the eight limbs, and they have to be captured in ascending form. Most important of that limb to overcome the Nirmamo, Nirahankar, Nispriha modality of Kama is Pratyahar. Pratyahar is the ability to say no. So always there is a fight or tug of war going on between the Indriya, which is wanting you to do Bhog, and the Buddhi, which wants you to do Yog. When I say Yog, think of three terms: Dhyan Yog, Karma Yog, and Bhakti Yog. What is Gyan Yog? Well, Gyan Yog is the ultimate union with Gyan or wisdom that you will attain through this. So nobody can say, I am doing Gyan Yog. The goal is Gyan Yog. Even if you are reading Swadhyay, which is one of the components of Niyam, Swadhyay is reading of the holy scriptures. Lot of you have asked me, where do you get all this knowledge? You can read stuff, Swadhyay, but that's not going to get you wisdom. Wisdom only happens when whatever you have read or experienced through the modality of guna is contemplated internally, introspected upon. Now, if you introspect upon it, that's the modality of Dhyan Yoga. If whatever you have understood and you have the humility and the gracious gratitude to give it back to the world, then you're doing Karma Yoga. When you're saying, I do not have the means to help other individuals, and I do not have the concentration, focus, or the peace to practice Dhyan Yoga in Brahma Muhurat, then you do Bhakti Yoga. That's why Kali Yuga, the easiest way to tune back into the realm of moksha is to do Bhakti Yoga. It is the cheapest, most convenient, easily available. It's like a generic drug. So it is very easy to get hold of. Turn on Hanuman Chalisa, some chanting, and start it. Anyways, so sthitpragya, I know of two distinct modalities to get sthitpragya stoic. The first is a pratyahara. Ashtang Yoga ka sabse jo important component hai, wo pratyahara hai. Pratyahara is the ability to say no. Now, both sensual enjoyments, bhog and rog, will be eliminated if you do pratyahara. सो नॉट ओनली योर डिजायर्स विल डाई बट ऑल्सो द सफरिंग जन्म मृत्यु जरा व्याधि दुख दोषानु दर्शनम ये जो दुख और दोष है ना विच आर बेसिकली थिंग्स लाइक डिजीज एंड ओल्ड एज दोज will go away because the prana, the vata has been distilled into prana and the prana is rising through the sushumna. That's what pratyahara is doing. What is pratyahara? Well, all of ashtanga yoga is pratyahara, but more specifically, if you want to think in the modern times, eating one meal a day, eating sattvic food that is not involving cruelty to animals, eating food that is sattvic. Sattvic food definition is food that is consumed within 3 hours of cooking. And food that does not involve any aggravation of the dosha. So you have to know your individual dosha, vat, pitta, and kapha, or a combination of those two, or three in some cases, tridosh. You have to know your dosha constitution. Eat according to your dosha, plus eat high pranic foods and highly sattvic foods. Watch my video on prana and pranic foods to know what are high pranic foods. Things like ash gourd, honey, ghee, kaddu. All those things are high pranic foods. And what are the negative pranic foods? Mostly the cruelty, animal farming, processed foods, foods containing plastic, leftovers, refrigerated, all these foods, hormonal foods, all these foods are negative. And nightshades are to some extent negative as well. But look at that video, prana versus pranic foods, that will help us understand high pranic foods, high sattvic foods according to the dosha vitiation. Those are the kind of foods that you have to eat. That is the right ahar. The second pratyahar is with water. Pratyahar itself is pratyahar. You have to restrict the food. But food can be anything that you intake, including the grains, the food grains, the water and the air. So pratyahar involves restriction of all these three elements. Food you did through one meal a day, intermittent fasting, especially if you combine it every 15 day. That is a great way to do the pratyahar, ekadashi fasting. The second is water. Water I have talked about, you have to drink water. If you are eating once a day, maybe drink water 4 or 5 times a day. That's the max. You cannot sip on water all day because that disturbs the electrolyte balance, especially sodium in the body. Also, drinking small quantities of water messes up your kidneys because they don't know when to excrete, filter out or retain the water. They don't know the amount of water that's coming. So drink only when you're thirsty. Drink good amounts of water. Drink the water slowly. Especially drink 1 or 2 liters of alkaline water that is infused with peppermint and lemon slices, infused in a copper vessel overnight, steeped with water, and then you drink that in the morning when you are empty stomach. That is the best way to detoxify the body. So that is the jal. The third is of the vayu. The vayu pratyahar happens through kumbhak. I love it. The best thing I know that I have found in the recent months is kumbhak pranayama, because kumbhak pranayama is the mother of all pranayamas. If you do kumbhak, abhyantar or bahya kumbhak, 1422, look at that video about asan bandh mudras, that is going to help you purify your manas. So remember how we said chitta, when polluted, becomes manas. Manas are the thoughts that are creating this twine of desires, that are creating karma, karma bandhan, punarjanam, and further trapment in the jeev loka. Whereas kumbhak is said to destroy the thoughts in your mind. How does that happen? So when you have watched my video Shiv Chitta versus Prana Shakti, we know that the Chitta is like the small Mahavat sitting on the elephant or the Prana. So Chitta is contained within the Prana, but Chitta controls the Prana. Chitta is contained within the prana, but chitta controls the prana. The Mahavat sits on the elephant, which is huge, and hopefully the Mahavat controls the elephant. However, on top of the elephant, or the elephant is on top of the earth. So even bigger than the prana is the vayu, because prana, the prana, mahaprana, which is the first prana that emanated the Srishti, has to come into the Mahabhuts, right? So what it created, it has to depend on. That's why Vayu is Marut, or Vayu. When you control the Vayu, which is what you do in Kumbhak, Abhyantar Kumbhak, you retain the Vayu inside you, and Bahya Kumbhak, you let everything go out and you're totally empty in your lungs. Those things, 1-4-2-2 is the ratio of inspiration, Abhyantar Kumbhak, expiration, and Bahya Kumbhak. When you do that ratio, then you are perfecting the art of कुंभक प्राणायाम विच इज हेल्पिंग प्यूरिफाई द वात दोष कंपोज्ड ऑफ वायु एंड आकाश डिस्टिल्ड इनटू प्राणा प्राणा विल फ्लो थ्रू द नाडीज गो इनटू द लोवेस्ट चक्र विच इज द जनरेटर चक्र द मूलाधारा प्राणिक जनरेटर नॉक ऑन इट मल्टीपल टाइम्स एंड इवेंचुअली इट विल ब्रेक इट एंड व्हेन इट ब्रेक्स इट सुषुम्ना विदम भित्वा सुखाद विशति मारुता सो सुषुम्ना विदम भित्वा व्हेन इट इज ब्रेकिंग द डोर ऑफ सुषुम्ना सुखाद यू एक्सप्लेन यू फील द प्लेजर एंड देन स्लोली द प्राणा इज लाइक अ सब्लिमेटरी फोर्स दैट इज राइजिंग अप एंड अप थ्रू द चक्रास अंटिल इट हिट्स द सहस्रारा विच इज लाइंग आउटसाइड द वर्टेक्स सो दैट इज द बेनिफिट ऑफ कुंभक प्राणा डिस्टिलेशन ऑफ वाता टू फॉर्म द प्राणा फ्लोइंग थ्रू द नाडीज into the muladhara, into the central tube of sushumna and keeps rising as you are overcoming each of the chakra emotions. The emotions of subsistence at the muladhara, creation procreation at swadhisthana, the passion of professional whatever satisfactions you want in life, of the manipura, compassion of the anahata, courage of the vishuddha, intuition of the ajna, bliss. Of Sahasrara. So you'll experience these emotions and that's how you know what chakra you are stuck at. If you get easily swayed when you see a cookie in front of you or you want to embrace a beautiful girl when she's sitting in front of you, you're still stuck at Swadhisthana. If you're so sick, you're dying, you're having cancer, you are just struggling to be alive, you're on multiple drips, your blood pressure is dropping, bring any cookie, bring any beautiful girl, you will never think of them because you are trying to be alive. Yaar, mere ko jeene do, yaar, main abhi jeelun, phir thoda, phir karun jo karna hai. Bhog kahan se karein? Rog se pareshan. So when rog has stuck you and you are just trying to meet the basic needs, you're at muladhara. When you have overcome your basic needs, then the carnal desires start. The create and procreate, the sensual arrangement, the bhogas of life, sensual enjoyment. That's why we say, त्रैविद्या माम सोमपा पूत पापा यज्ञ इष्टवा स्वर्गतिम प्रार्थयन्ते ते पुण्य मसाद सुरेंद्र लोकम अश्नन्ति दिव्यान दिवि देव भोगान तेतम भुक्त्वा स्वर्गलोकम विशालम क्षीणे पुण्य मर्त्य लोकम विशन्ति एवं त्रैधम मनु प्रपन्ना गता गतम काम काम लभन्ते दोज हु आर एल्यूड बाय द वेदिक पोर्शन द रिचुअल कर्मकांड portions of Vedas, they will do certain havans in a certain way, we will say certain number of mantras in a day, we will do certain rituals to overcome our papas. Well, that is not the ideal way to burn your papas because then you are still engrossed by the indriyas. You have to understand that indriyas, Indra is the deva of deva, is the god of gods, is the god of heaven. Your goal is not to go to heaven. Heaven is still within the three lok. So bhulok, bhualok, swarglok, it is still within the three lok. So you have to transcend all the lokas to go to Vaikunth Lok in our case, as Hinduism teaches us, but basically to go to the realm of the undivided unity that is called Shiv Chit. Because from there you are the witnesser in chief who is not wanting to enjoy, but enjoyment is bestowed upon him by the fact that he is the internal introvert witnesser who wants to establish compassion and Brahmanical neutrality. So those who are wishing to worship these gods, the idolatory worship, which is great by the way, because idolatory worship is one way of connecting, bhakti yoga. Instant connection happens when you see a picture of Hanuman, Shiv. Great. When you start with the personal worship of God and then you become impersonal at some point. You don't become, actually that just happens to you. If it doesn't happen to you, that's fine too. You can remain in the realm of what Ramakrishna Paramhans was doing versus Vivekananda is more impersonal. He doesn't glorify any particular devas. Like Ramakrishna Paramhans' guru was more personal. So there are satyam ekam vipra bahudha bhavanti. The truth is one. The paths to the truth are multiple. So you can have idolatory worship. You can have impersonal Brahman worship. Dvaita dvaita. Don't get into those. Just do what you like because you are born with certain samskaras which are just pushing you in a certain direction and you have to utilize those instincts to determine whether you are a person of Dhyan Yoga, Karma Yoga or Bhakti Yoga. Whether you are a person of personal introspection in Brahma Muhurat or you are a person who loves to chant and sing and love the Indriyas or you are a person who wants to do something, the Rajasic passion. You want to convert that into helping others through philanthropy, charity, etc. So those are the modalities, the three yogas that are best suited for the individuals who are having Sattvic, Rasic, Tamasic tendencies or Vat, Pitt, Kapha tendencies. You can always connect everything to each other. Some people say, how can you connect Nadi system with the Guna system? How can you connect the Guna system with the Dosha system? सर्वभूतेषु येन एकं भावं मां व्यमिच्छते अविभक्तं विभक्तेषु तज्ज्ञानं विद्धि सात्विकम्। इफ यू आर एबल टू सी द कंपैशन, इफ यू आर एबल टू सी द कनेक्शन बिटवीन वेरियस एंटिटीज, देन यू आर स्लोली ट्रांसेंडिंग द ट्रैप ऑफ माया। And that is why when someone gets angry at you, if you can identify the reason why they got angry at you, you are connecting with that individual, although you do not agree with the way they responded, you have raised your levels. Instead of becoming vindictive, you have become more rationalizing. That's the kind of quality that we have to develop when we are trying to develop modes of kindness, compassion. So that is sthit pragya or stoicism, which can happen through pratyahar, one meal a day, alkaline water, kumbhak pranayama. The fourth thing you can do, and that is more at the ethereal level, because you have transcended the food, water, air, left is fire and ether. So those elements are more of Shraddha. Shraddha is the internal flame, the flame of faith. Faith will only grow stronger every time you try to demolish it. Every time you challenge a faith, the faith gets stronger. Belief might be broken, but faith will only get firmer with time with every challenge. And that is the story of Prahlad. That is the story of people who have enormous faith or Shraddha. And that's why you'll see the power of intuition or the secrets, that book. When you have certain strong intention that you're throwing, a sankalp in the universe, or you have a certain Shraddha or faith, nothing can break it down because you don't question it. At that point, there is no rationalization, no speculation. There is no desire. You just believe strongly in something, and that is why it's called faith. Higher than belief. So once you have inclination, hopefully it stays long enough to become a belief, which stays long enough to become faith or Shraddha. So it's very hard to break Shraddha. Shraddha doesn't break. It's the ethereal realm. Shraddha, saya Shraddha itta syara dhanmite labte tata kaman maya vihi tanitan. Who have Shraddha in the Devas, like Indra Dev and Lakshmi Devi, Durga Mata. These people will be enormously benefited short term. They will be enormously benefited short term. They will get a lot of prosperity from Lakshmi. They will get a lot of muscular power from Durga. They will get a lot of things done by the gods, which is great. Which is great. Better than being agnostic or atheist is to believe in whoever god you want to believe. And that's a good start because you get the benefits if you pray. If you say Aditya Hridayam, I have heard if you chant it like 9 times continuously for 9 days, a lot of time Aditya or sun god will help you. Just the way he helped Rama demolish Ravana. So the same way, these things can be done to meet material needs. But he also says, Satya Shraddha Yukta Syara Dhan Mite Lapte Jatata Kaman Maya Vihi Tanitan Antvattu Phalam Sheshan Tad Bhavate Alp Meshan Devan Devi Yajanti Ma Bhakta Yanti Mamapi. The Antvattu Phalam Teshan, Antvattu Perishable, Antvattu Phalam Teshan Tad Bhavate Alp Medesham. People of limited intellect are asking for material gains, because material gains are perishable. When your life ends, the material gains, the gold you have collected, the money you have made, the success and fame, they will die with you. The only thing that will carry off is your karma bandhans, the leftover karma. Have you increased your karma? Have you increased your desires that, oh God, I wanted to be rich. Thank you, Lakshmi Ma, you gave me so much money. God, if I could be more rich. Well, the next time you'll get more money, but you'll still be in this world. You'll still go through the pains of jan, mrityu, jara, vyadi, birth, disease, old age, death. Those are 4 painful modalities that everyone has to transgress through a biological life as a jeev or a bhoot. So that's why Shraddha is important. It works on the ethereal component, and Pratyahar works on the bhoot component, food, water, and air. Whereas Shraddha is working more on the fire and the ether components. That is helping you get into bhakti yoga, connect with your God, and short-term gains, quick gains will be attained through worship of the devatas. But the devatas themselves are under authority of the supreme Brahma, Paramatma, Parameshwar. That is why materialization happens through them. But if you are going for the highest loka, then you are safe, because you don't have to come back. You don't have to ask for material pleasures. They will be granted to you. All the difficulties that are happening in your path, if you are going for the highest power authority to believe in bliss, anand, to believe in Brahma, then you are overcoming it. I am not propounding one way of idolatry versus for the other, power of manifest versus unmanifest. Please be clear. Go with what benefits your personality and stick with it, and let that thing decide and dictate the way your journey, the spiritual path, evolves. Okay, so Pratyahara and Shraddha will convert the kaam, sakam karma, loaded with karma bandhan, into sthit pragya through the modality of yoga, dhyan yoga, in meditation, in Brahma Muhurat, Karma Yoga, Nishkam Karma, helping others without having any desires for fruitive awards, and Bhakti Yoga, selfless surrender. The selfless surrender helps you rise. Yogam Atishta Tishtati. When you're situated in yoga, you will rise. Just like Vata, when it is purified, becomes Prana, it will rise in Sushumna. The rise shows the progress in the spiritual path, becoming from more materialistic to non-materialistic, believing in becoming the Satchit Anand, the Roop, the form that you were prior to coming as a Jeeva or a biological body in this earth. So once the Pratyahara and Shraddha happens, the desires which were shrouded by demands and doubts are dispelled. Tasmat gyan sambhutam ristam gyan sinat mana chitvainam sanshayam yoga tishtitisht bharata. When you are situated in yoga, once you have become a yogi in a peaceful mode, you practice more and more yoga, you get the gyan. Bahunam gyan vanantes. Bahunam janmanante gyan van mam prapadyate vasudeva sarvamiti sa mahatma su durlabh. After many births, when an individual has obtained the final gyan, he knows that Vasudev, here refers to the Vaikunth Lok, Krishna of course, but it refers to the highest unmanifest eternal supreme power, which is the personification of Brahman. That when you know Vasudeva Sarvamitisa Mahatma Sudurlabh. So that is why the gyan, when it hits, after all the janmas, gyan van mam prapadyate, once you have gotten the wisdom, then you know that Vasudev is everything, I have to become gunatit, beyond the three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas. You don't become gunatit, gunatit happens to you. You don't become enlightenment happens to you. So know that, at some point you have to apply the force, and at some point the escape velocity takes over, and you are just rushed over there. You don't have any control over not becoming enlightened or becoming enlightened. You can only do the sankalp. You can push the first engine. But after that, once the momentum is there, it will take you there. So that is the power of gyan. But also remember, just like we said, yanti devata devan, pitrin yanti pitrivata, bhutani yanti utejya, manti abjanoti mam. Whoever desires their ancestors goes to the loka of ancestors. Whoever loves the gods, Lakshmi, Saraswati, Durga will go to the realm of the wisdom, prosperity. But tetam bhuktva svargalokam vishalam shivne punne martya lokam vishanti evam traidham manu prapanna gata gatam kam kama labante. Once they have gone to these heavenly abodes, Indra, Surendra, Sur Indra. Surendra is Sur and Indra. Sur is the devta and Indra is the god of the gods. But look, the word Indra itself means sensations. So you're getting all the bhog in svargalok. You will feel very happy, just like you feel very happy in dream, it will feel like that. But it's just prolonged. And that is the Swarglok. But it will end. Once you have Tetam Bhuktva Swarglokam Vishalam, Shine Punne Martya Lokam Vishanti. The moment their punyas or the all the good deeds have been burnt out, they will fall back on earth. Gata Gatam Kam Kama Labante. The going and coming continues. That's why Sataya Shraddha Yukta Saradhan Mite, when you deposit your Shraddha in the gods of personification and prosperity, you are getting quick results, but the results are short-lived, and you have a shraddha that is deposited on the lower gods, which themselves is an improper way, Krishna says, of worshipping me. So it's a way of worshipping, totally fine, but it's probably not the best way to worship me, because even when you have the shraddha in the gods, you're trying to be a good person and submitting. Your ego is decimated, no matter whether you have idolatry worship or unmanifest worship. So that's a good way of decimating the ego, which is causing the calm. And the best way is to let good things happen to you, not seek personal gratification, rewards, women, gold, money, success, fame, but let them come to you. But you believe in Brahman, you believe in the buddhi, the Brahmanical neutrality, and sar dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraj. Come to my abode without working about all these chores. That is the way we have to be established. So that is the path to moksha. And once there is, you are in moksha, you can still come back as avdhut and avtaras. But those are only to do protection of dharma. Just like Krishna takes, Supreme Personality takes the roop of Krishna. यदा यदा धर्मस्य ग्लानिर्भवति भारत अभ्युत्थानम् अधर्मस्य दधात्मनम् संजाम्यम् परित्राणाय साधूनां विनाशाय च दुष्कृता धर्म संस्थापनार्थाय संभवानि युगे युगे फॉर द रिस्टोरेशन ऑफ सात्विक बैलेंस व्हेन कलियुगा देयर इज टू मच ऑफ तमस गोइंग ऑन टू मच ऑफ अहंकार बलम दर्पम काम क्रोध संशयता ऑल दीज ईगो वेननेस वैनिटी सबऑर्डिनेशन एंड सप्रेशन आर गोइंग ऑन देन टू रीएस्टैब्लिश द ब्राह्मनिक न्यूट्रलिटी Krishna comes. That way Avatara comes to help his other souls in the world who are trapped in this. So, my friends, in short, desires are going to cause demands which will lead to destruction of compassion and anhata. So, it kills the awareness. Desires create doubts or skepticism which again leads to tamasic ignorance or agyan. And desires will continue this vicious cycle of creating more demands and doubts, which in turn are making you more muddha, sinking you in the karma bandhan with every single life. That's why desires are bad. The lesser desires you have, the better off you are. When you have desires, try to have the higher version desires, which I have talked about in decoding desires or the other lectures on desires. Basically, you don't think about indriya bhog or the pleasure from the senses desire, the sensual desires. Above those are the mental desires of passion at Manipura. Above them are the intellectual desires of Anhata, which wants to establish the Brahmanical neutrality and preserve the Dharma. And all that is the ethereal desire in which the consciousness is submerged in the superconscious Sahasrara. That is the template of desire that we have to follow. Please look at the videos on desire in the recent ones that we have made. So, once we know that the lower desires, the sensual desires, mental desires are not the ones we should pursue, we go in the mode of peace. In the mode of peace, there's not enough hankering. How do you know you're in peace? You don't have many thoughts in your brain and you're not subjected to the emotional turbulence. You don't get anxiety, fear, greed, resentment, guilt. These things don't come to you. When they come to you, you just observe them and let them pass off. Because they are just vritti waves that come and then they go back in the ocean. And then the ocean becomes very quiet. So you have to just observe the waves and let it pass off. And how can you let it pass off? Through the modality of pratyahara. One meal a day, alkaline water drinking few times a day, kumbhak pranayama and shraddha. When you do these things in dharana, dhyana, you go into samadhi, which is the last stage, the bliss. When you become gunatit, you have become beyond the realms of sattva, rajas, tamas. When your tridosh, vat, pitta and kapha have been totally balanced, you have become nirdosh from tridosh. And that is the realm in which the Shiv Chitta has regained, the nucleus has regained the control over the atom, and the pranic electrons can continue swinging around, but the nucleus is not affected. And the prana, that's why, cannot continuously expand, but remain close in those electronic orbits around the nucleus. And hence, the integrity of Satchitanand, the integrity of Brahman is restored. Hope you like this video. Please feel free to leave your comments below. Jai Shri Ram.